Well, good morning. Good morning. Here we are, week 7. And these are my responses to what you've been talking about in your responses so far this week as you get ready to start to do your interactions. You're going to see me looking down here. That's because I'm pulling up your responses to work through them. Overall, let me thank you for the ways you're thinking, the ways you're really working through these pieces. You really now have me thinking, so I'm really grateful. Thank you. Let me say a word about about values, because values are really an important piece of what we're talking. Some of you are talking about. You'll forgive me as I'm not pulling up your names directly, but we're talking. We've talked about how love and encouragement and even healing would be one of our quadrants. Well, let me say that those are values, and what's really important to keep in mind with fractals, these are your core pieces. These are the four pieces that have to be in place for a church to succeed. That's why we consider them to be invite, how we get people into the church or into our classes, into whatever it is that's where we're trying to get them. For some churches, that's mission. One of the early learnings I had in church planting was to draw a picture of our church, not the outside. So, of course, we didn't have a church building. So it was what would your maybe rough layout be, and how are you going to get people in? Is it through the front door worship? Is it through a back door, perhaps, children's ministries or young adult ministries, adult ministries? That could be a back door, possibly, or mission could be a back door, or side events that are going on could be side doors. But whatever it was, where you wanted people to get, actually, that's what needed to be in the center. Education, worship. At that time, most people thought in terms of where they really wanted to get people was in worship. So that's what that invite core, how you get people in, that's one piece. Now, I want to be careful as I'm saying that, because I am not saying to you that these are things you need to be doing for invite, right? What I'm saying to you is there has to be invite mechanism. That has to be a quadrant of your fractal. Connecting is another piece. There's a connecting people with God, connecting people with one another, and connecting people with the church. It's said that, well, I think many of us, maybe even most of us, would say, well, we want them connected to God, right? The reality is most people will connect to another person or with other people before they'll connect with the church and with God. Or it may be other people, the church, and with God. Often God is the third piece. Now, with more people being spiritual rather than religious, more and more people, then we might see people coming in with a connection to the divine. And if I could just make a side comment, last night I met this couple and the man, they're in their 30s. This man told me that his God, the divine for him, is Star Wars and the Force. I didn't know how to respond to that. That was a new one to me. So I'll just toss that out to your thinking caps for the day. No need for response, just to give you another example of what is out there. Anyways, that's our connecting. We're trying to connect people, and we are trying to connect people with the church, our congregation, right? That's what holds them together. That's where discipling is, a piece of discipling. We want them to connect with our church, with one another, and then, of course, ultimately with God. Then we get that discipling. It's not merely education. A key to implementing fractals in our churches is to see where our church is and make the bridge to where it can be. Some of you have talked about that in terms of making the connection, the bridge. You may not have realized you were doing bridge, or maybe you did, saying, hey, this is what we've got now in our congregation, and this is how that that looks or that's termed in or could be within the fractal type language. Good job. Exactly. We take what we are and we make the bridge to where we want us to be. That being said, then, over and over again, I consider our education ministries to be, or they're not yet, but that's the place where discipling comes into being, so or into place. So you're going to flesh that out. Some of you talked about using the pre-Christian, Christian, disciple, and missionary, apostle, that progression. I personally like that. In that discipling, I also like calling it discipling. I want to encourage you to do that because education really does carry the connotation that it's in our head, right? We're educating, not discipling. And as some of you talked about leadership, some of you wanted to put leadership development in a quadrant of its own. All of this is looking at leadership and discipling. Part of discipling is that leadership. Look at your movements, your stages from last week, and hopefully you'll see that discipling is that leadership piece. That's where people are discipling other people. So that's where your leadership development takes place. It's in that educational realm in our, I'm sorry, antiquated. No, I'm not sorry, but it is antiquated way of thinking. And it's antiquated, and yet it's not biblical in so many respects. You see over and over again in our New Testament examples, there is that nurturing, that discipleship. I could make that argument even within the Old Testament pieces. It's biblical all along. So think in terms of discipleship. You don't have to call it that in your church, but teach your leaders, or if you're the one who leads those, that area, that department, that commission, committee, whatever you call that, be thinking about that and begin to teach your people around that. You might even share last week's movement, if you haven't thought about when you could do that, about how are you thinking that. Dawn Marie, I think it was you who brought up about really thinking in terms of your fractals and pre-Christian, Christian, disciple, and disciple, missionary, and each one of those fractals, definitely be thinking of those within those terms. So that's the huge piece to me, is I want you to have those four core pieces of the church, and they truly are inviting, connecting, discipling, and sending. And people can come in at any one of those, in any one of those areas. Some come in because of your Sunday school or other opportunities to connect. And some are going to come through your missional pieces. Some of your people may come into discipleship. And if that would be where your prayer pieces are, your small groups are there, although you can have small groups in. See how this all gets within that? In fact, one of the churches I pastored many years ago, one of our fractals was caring. And that's where we really worked with our elders to our shepherding program was in caring. Our hospital response team was in caring. Our long-term pieces, we had like critical care in there for people who are in the hospital. We had long-term care. We had transitional care. So that was one of our fractals. I want to encourage you to stick with four. Those of you who have oversight of education ministries, you're spot on thinking about age groups and then sub-fractals. Remember in fractals, you have your four core. And then off each one of those, you're going to have four more. So if you're doing discipling, then one of those cores can definitely be your age or stage, right? Or you know, you can have family within that first tier, or what would that be? Your base, your first tier fractal. And then what I might do is then for each of those age or stages, I would sub that or sub each one of those into pre-Christian, Christian, disciple, and missionary, apostle. I'm hoping that helps in some way. Let me just see if I can pick up on anything else that I have forgotten. I really like that seek, teach, send, Adam. That's in front of me at this moment. Talent and placement, that's a key part of your mission fractal or your sending fractal. We have those personal ministry assessments. Again, in one of the churches that I served, we used personal ministry assessments. We couldn't get everybody in the church at that time to use it, but every new person into the church, everybody who came in part of our introductory classes, we had the basic introductory class. The second tier of that introductory class was to work with the PMA. This is what I call a personal ministry assessment, and to do a personal ministry consultation. And that talked then about how they could do ministry within the community amongst those that they know, and then also how to do ministry within the church. To pick up on Rick Warren's language, I really appreciate this and see it so clearly. There's mission and there's ministry. Mission is the work we do outside the church. Ministry is the work that we do inside the church. All of us have missional pieces of us as well as ministry pieces of us. So the PMA would talk about your missional and then about the ministry. It also had the component of what are your next steps for growing? How are you going to grow into, early on I didn't talk in terms of into being a disciple, but I'd say, how are you going to grow into your faith? How are you going to grow into your faithfulness? How are you going to grow into mission and ministry? And then based on the pieces of that personal ministry assessment, we were able to give that more information. I will say that my husband, Dr. Bill, uses this in his congregation as I did. This is part of their introductory for new members. They also started with asking the elders, I think, at making as much as one can make elders or deacons and or deacons to do this. The assessment. What else do I want to say about all of that? I think I have it there. I keep working with these, with your pieces. Keep thinking about it and be asking, ask me some, if you've got more questions or thoughts about that, go ahead and reply beneath this post, and I will be back on this evening. I'll be checking on them and see where we need to go for tomorrow afternoon's posting video. Have a really great day. Thank you again. Just you all are amazing. Thank you for the ways you're thinking and staying on top of this. I appreciate you so much. Yes, have a great day. Bye-bye.